Welcome to worship with Portage United Church of Christ here in Portage, Michigan. This is worship for the first week of Lent, which is the week of March 6th, 2022. And this week we begin a new worship series, a worship series called Good Enough, Embracing the Imperfections of Life and Faith. Friends, we live in a culture that is bent on definitions of the good life as continuous upward mobility, climbing ladders of prosperity and achievement so that we can post ever more likable posts onto our social media accounts. Always makes us feel like we are doing a great thing and living a great life when we get lots of likes on Instagram or Facebook. But life happens to us, right? And a lot of us don't lead those lives of continuous upward mobility and prosperity. More often than not, we're slipping off the rungs or repairing the rungs that we just slipped off of on that glamorous ladder of success. So what if we just stepped back and took a pause from it all, and instead of climbing, started cultivating and tending and fertilizing gardens of life right where we are? Welcome this season to a Lent of affirming a faith in which we are blessed regardless, and where we can lean into embracing our good enough lives as holy and sacred where we are. So I invite you now to rest your body, get settled and get comfortable, and let's prepare our hearts and our minds and our bodies for worship. The liturgical season of Lent developed over the centuries as a time of deepening reflection. Originally a period of preparation for baptisms on Easter Eve, it later became a time for all Christians to take stock of their lives and examine how the connection to their faith was progressing, or not, and to recommit to a life of goodness. This year, we will indeed open up and take stock. But rather than feel guilty about what we haven't accomplished in our lives in faith, we will spend some time questioning how our culture's obsession with achievement and perfection actually keeps us from the true depths of life and faith. This Lent, we'll take some time to turn ladder climbing into garden tending, nurturing our souls and embracing our holy, good enough lives. Let us pray together. Holy One, our refuge and shelter, we call out to you sometimes in praise, sometimes in distress, as life goes. Whether we perceive it or not, you are there. Open us this day to your presence in the smile of a friend, in the call of a bird, in the simple and good enough moments that fill our days. Amen.
Take this moment, sign and space. Take my friends around. Here among us, make the place where your love is found. Take the time to call my name. Take the time to
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. My goal this week was to write a good enough sermon. I should have realized right off the bat that that goal was never going to be attainable because, you see, I suffer, along with my mom and my two sisters, from an affliction we very affectionately call German Midwest Protestant guilt. Now, those of you who are native to this part of Southwest or just Western Michigan might have experienced this more as Dutch Midwest Protestant guilt. Either way, this type of guilt is essentially this unspoken, unwritten awareness or knowledge that good enough, it's never really good enough. And we feel guilty for not being better, for not trying harder, for not doing better. Now, just to be clear, it's not just Northern European white folks who have a corner on the market of this type of guilt. You've probably also heard of Catholic guilt. And of course, there's also Jewish guilt. And then there's all sorts of nuances for this good enough is never really good enough type of guilt for the folks who live on the margins of the dominant white culture. But no matter what, everyone has parts of their lives where they just know that good enough is not acceptable. Maybe it's school and your grades. And that average grade, well, that's not good enough. We have to get better than average. Maybe it's your body image. Too fat, never thin enough, too skinny, never full enough, not tall enough, not short enough, not muscular enough. Maybe it's in your relationships with your friends and your family. Have you ever said to a loved one, or has a loved one ever said to you, nothing is ever good enough for you? This problem exists in churches too. I saw it in the very first church I served back in the 90s, and yes, I've also seen it in this church. We don't have enough people. We need more young families. We need more energy and more money. All of these things are just another way of saying who we are and what we have isn't good enough. We live in a culture, we have fallen prey to a culture that has decided that good enough means settling for mediocre. It means settling for eh. And while this might be an okay place to start, good enough is never the place you want to stay. Ultimately, we all must aspire to be and to do more. Now, this is really a ridiculous notion for people like us who are part of a faith tradition that affirms that everything God creates is declared good. And everything God creates is given to us in quantities that are enough. After all, the words in Genesis are, and God saw all that she had made, and indeed, it was very good. Genesis does not say, and God saw all that he had made, and indeed, it was good enough. How did good and enough become something that is neither? Somewhere along the line, our lives and our world got so big and so busy that we became disconnected from the goodness of our very createdness, a createdness that was birthed in dirt and the breath of God. Two things that are ubiquitous in our world and therefore constant reminders to us of our sacred good enoughness. We just became too busy, too famished to pay attention to the dirt under our feet and the air that we breathe. When Jesus is tempted in the wilderness, Satan is not trying to get him to do bad things, you know. He's not trying to get Jesus to turn away from God. Satan is trying to get Jesus to question who he is. You know, being God's beloved son, like you just heard when you got baptized, that might be good, but is it really enough? Maybe what God has called you to do is good, but wouldn't you really like to have some tangible evidence of it? You know, something like some bread to eat when you're famished, enough power to make the world a truly just and better place, some angels to protect you when you just happen to fall off a really tall building. And Jesus says, nope, I'm good enough. Just the way I am. That is a pretty remarkable response, because it's hard to remember the truth of who you are when you're famished. Whether we are literally famished for food or famished maybe for confidence, acceptance, approval, companionship, or just a good night's sleep. Shiny things, those concrete evidences that the world will recognize, they are tempting. You know, like working our tails off for an A instead of a B. Like finding just the right diet plan or exercise plan to get the body that we really want. Like finding the right program to get more people sitting in our pews on Sunday morning. Like the right job or the right neighborhood, the house, the car, the vacation that we really can't afford, but oh, makes us feel good and it'll be great pictures to post on Facebook. Pile enough of that stuff on, we aren't gonna feel a whole lot more confidence in the end. We're not going to find that much more approval or get that much more sleep. But we are going to find that we have become disconnected from our good enough self. The good enough, just as we are. So maybe a Lenten fast is in order. Not the kind of Lenten fast we do because we feel guilty for not being as good as we could have or as good as we should have. Let's fast from all those shiny things that tempt us from the truth of who we are. Let's fast from those words that we say to ourselves in the morning when we look in the mirror, those words we say to one another when we look around and don't see enough people in the pews. Let's fast from those images that we aspire to achieve. Let's fast from all that stuff we pile on top of ourselves whenever we've decided that we just aren't good enough right now. Who we are and where we are. fasting from all these aspirations that stem from this sense of not being good enough, letting go of all of those things is the only way that we will once again connect with our sacred, good enough self. The good enough that was instilled in us at the very dawn of creation. Indeed, you are very good. The good enough affirmed in us at our baptism. You are my beloved child. This Lent, let's fast from those things that tempt us to reject being good enough. And let's aspire to live fully as beloved children of God, as a beloved community of God, created good and created enough. We find ourselves hungry for many things that we believe will bring us satisfaction. In today's gospel, the devil lays a bet that Jesus will jump at the chance for glory, fame, and the quick fix. Who wouldn't? But Jesus keeps up the pithy one-liners long enough that the tempter just has to slink away. What are the temptations that catch your ear, singing out promises that your life should be more special than it is? What if ordinary life is already holy, as is? Let us take a moment of silent reflection. Hear this compassionate word from the letter to the Romans. The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Know that already God is offering us freedom from the temptations of the not enoughness of our time, inviting us to love and revere the seeming ordinariness of the day to day, so that we might recognize its true beauty. And know that despite our sometimes faltering steps, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are being forgiven even now. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God, and amen. And let us pray together now with the confidence of the children of God, the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you for starting your Lenten journey with us this week. I do hope you remember that you are always more than welcome to come join us in person in worship at 11 a.m. on Sunday mornings, as well as continue to watch us online anytime or any day of the week. This Lenten series is based on a book by Kate Bowler called Good Enough, 40-ish devotionals for a life of imperfection. If you would like to get the book and read along as we go through this series, I would encourage you to do so. We are also having some small group conversations around the readings for each week, and those are taking place on Sunday mornings before worship in person, or Thursday evenings in a hybrid format. So if you would like some more information on those, please feel free to email the church or call our church office, and you can join us and get to know some of us a little bit better. So, my friends, as you go forth, may the God who loves all of creation, especially the ordinary parts, and Jesus, our companion on this crooked path called life, and the Holy Spirit, who loves to improvise in surprising ways, be with you, dwell among you, and give you joy. Amen.
We pray for peace, O God of love and justice, as once again we face a time of war. The meek and humble try amid the crisis to love and build and nurture and restore. May lead us here, the truth the prophets teach us, that gifts of peace are worth the struggling for. We pray for peace, O Christ, who calmed the waters, who stilled the storm, who stilled disciples' fear. You spoke with love and with amazing power. Be with us now, when trouble is so near. May lead us see the miracle you offer, that words and deeds can calm the nations here. We pray for peace, O Spirit, here among us. Your love emboldens, judges and restrains. Take any hate and acts of impulse from us. Make leaders wise amid competing claims. May we seek peace, O God of love and justice. May love and mercy be our highest aim.